Thanks, everyone. I'm happy to be there with this nice weather compared to Paris, where it's really raining, and it's cold and everything, and it's the summer here, so that's really awesome. So, a Groovy journey in open source land. There's a bit of overlap with actually what Ken did, but well, it's okay. We have different ways of presenting things. So I'm Guillaume Laforge. I've been working on Groovy for the past 13 years and more. So at the Apache Foundation, I'm the chair of the Apache Groovy projects. And there's a little scoop there. I'm actually joining Google next week, and I'll be a developer advocate for the Google Cloud platform starting next Monday. So that's why I didn't put my company on there, actually. Manning, the fine folks of Manning gave us a promo code for those who want to buy Groovy in Action, or actually any of the Manning books. There's a promotion code which gives you 39% off any of the Manning books. So don't hesitate to copy that. And okay, let's do a little bit of history. So Groovy started in 2003. That was when the 24 series launched. Two guys, James Strachan and Bob MacWhirter, actually started the project. And they were playing with Python, and they were Java developers. They also had some Smalltalk background. And they were feeling like, okay, we could make Java more Groovy somehow. And this is actually really how the name stuck. Where the name came from, so that's really Jim saying, wouldn't he be Groovy if we could do this and that in Java? So they decided to spin off their own Java-like language. So that was in August 2003. So yeah, Groovy will be 13 pretty soon. And even back in 2003. So there were closures. So it's been there for a long time. The native syntax for lists and maps and so on, all that was there already, and all the nice GDK shortcut methods there. Well, not all of them, but at least that was there already as well. So the Groovy you're using already today, I mean, it's pretty much what was envisioned, and what the first version of Groovy was already pretty much like that already. And it was purely dynamically typed. Just a few months after the beginning of the project, I joined the project. I was submitting patches, and James Strachan asked me to become a committer, so that he wouldn't have to continue applying the patches himself, and I could, you know, help myself and take care of that. And a year or two after that, the founders left the project and worked on all the things. So I somehow implicitly and then officially later on became the project lead for Groovy. In 2004, the launch of Facebook and Java 5. And that's also when we worked on a new parser in order to add some Java 5 features to the language, like annotations and so on. And that's also when Jochen joined the project. So after me, he's the second oldest contributor to the project. And even in 2004, there were already people saying that Groovy was sinking, and you know, you know where it is today. So from promises of failure, darkness, sorry, deliver. And that was the guy from the bio blog, Hani Suleiman. Not many people remember that, but well, that was more than 10 years ago. In 2005, the launch of Rails. 2006 for the football players. are there any Italian guy in the room? No? Okay.
Good. There was Java 6 being released, and the first one to actually get paid to work full time on Groovy, that was Jochen.
Yeah.
Congratulations. In 2007, with the iPhone launch, that's when we released the first 1.0 version of Groovy. So it took us basically 4 years to get there. But we had some pretty high standards in terms of the level of, the number or level or quality of features that we wanted to support. So it took us 4 years to mature Groovy, to make it a 1.0 release. And we also launched G2One, so it's a small startup focusing on Groovy and Grails. That's also when Gradle was, if not created, that is the inception of Gradle was in 2007. And that's also the year where, and actually when I met Hans Doctor, that was at Grails Exchange, now called Groovy Grails Exchange, in 2007. And that was when we discussed what we could be doing in terms of build, automation, etc. So it was born, Gradle was born more or less there in 2007. And Spark seems like, it's an important year, right? Lots of good stuff happening there in 2007. Spark, just like Gradle, so Spark wasn't released then, but I was chatting with Peter Niedervieser in 2007, I think that was during the DevOps conference in Belgium, that he talked to me about what he was working on Spark. And it was really only released a year or two later on, but I knew about it like 1 or 2 years before everybody learned about it in the Groovy community. Groovy 1.5, so yeah, that's really where we added the full Java 5 support. And another big feature was the joint compiler. Before, it was a bit painful to mix, well, you had ways to do that, but it was a bit painful to mix Java and Groovy together. But with a joint compiler, we could now easily, have, let's say, a Java interface implemented in Groovy and a Java class extending the Groovy class, really the circular dependency between the languages. That's where it came from. And in the next talk in this room, Jochen will be also speaking about joint compilation, the future of joint compilation for Groovy. And the third oldest Groovy contributor, a major one, that's Paul King. Last year, Cedric wrote a blog post about some stats about who contributed to Groovy, etc. And he, Paul is clearly the biggest committer on the Groovy project ever since, in terms of number of commits and the importance of those commits, the size of them. 2008, well, it's a French movie, so perhaps I don't know if you know about it, but it's quite a famous one. And here's GreatConf. First one, SpringSource acquires G2One. And we have Griffin, first version of Griffin, EasyB. Who remembers EasyB? Okay, a couple of hands. So it was a behavior-driven testing framework. It's been more or less abandoned since then. And Groovy++. Who knew about Groovy++? A fork of Groovy? Yeah, another couple of hands. So Alex Katzman, one of the co-founders of G2One, did a fork of Groovy called Groovy++ to add static compilation to Groovy. So he did that in his own way, let's say, which wasn't exactly how I envisioned adding static compilation to Groovy. But ultimately, it really inspired us to add this static compilation, so it was a nice experiment for us to learn from. And we did our own way of doing that with static type checking and static compilation. But that was a great experiment to really decide how we wanted to do things in that area. 2009, the passing of Michael Jackson. And that was the famous quote that Ken mentioned this morning. So it was a bit unfortunate because it's been taken out of context. And Scala fanboys reuse that quote
you know, endlessly. But it's like, you know, if ska or Cotlin or Salen, etc., had existed back in the day where Groovy was created, there was no incentive for creating a new language because those languages are nice enough and good enough. And it's like, so this is Galen King, the creator of Hibernate, imagine that JPA had existed when he created Hibernate. Do you think he would have created Hibernate? Probably not. That's I'm quite logical, but time is what it is, and when we created Groovy, all the other stuff didn't exist, right? And all those other languages also learned from Groovy, some interesting stuff. And JPA learned from what Hibernate did as well. And the little story about James Strachan was that, so he started with Groovy, he moved to Scala, and then to Kotlin, and then back to Groovy again. So, you know, can you trust someone who, you know, whose attention span is, you know, moving around all the time, you know. But, well, he had some good things to say about Groovy, and he was particularly using the job DSL in Jenkins, which is all Groovy. And he had a couple of tweets like this, where he was really enjoying using Groovy again, and was happy with this language again. Yeah, the third, another one, at a conference where it was, there was a microservices oriented conference where, again, he was happy to see Groovy being used. Then, after the Spring Source acquisition of G2.1, VMware acquired Spring Source, and plenty other projects emerged. Jeepers, Gaelic for running Groovy on Google App Engine, Jeb for functional web testing, Kona for static analysis. Groovy 1.6, lots of performance improvements, multiple assignments, and that's really the beginning of AST transformations. So that was the big release, introducing AST transformations, which have been so important for Groovy since then. And Grab as well was creating Groovy 1.6. So it's really an important release in the life of the project. In Groovy 1.7, I highlighted power assets because we stole that. Actually, Peter Nierwieser contributed that into Groovy, but it was actually coming from the spot testing framework. So it's been one of the nice features of that release. In 2010, with the volcano exploding, I was stuck in Minneapolis for Great Conf US for a week because there were no planes going back home. And Rat Pack was created. Groovy served G-contract for programming by contracts with Groovy. 2011, another big year for the Earth, let's say. Greach, the first edition of Greach in Spain. Java 7, Vertex, Groovy FX, Groovy 1.8. Also a release that I really liked because we introduced common chain expressions, so that's the ability to chain method calls without any dots and parents, etc. And I think it's an important release for Groovy DSLs because that really opened the doors for some more readable and powerful DSLs, almost plain English-like DSLs thanks to that feature. The JSON support, and we bundle shippers. And Cedric joins the team. We moved to GitHub, and we discovered the boson of Higgs, the Higgs boson. Some external usage of Groovy in some project at Netflix or at LinkedIn. And to this date, as far as I know, Netflix is probably the largest web-scale deployment of Groovy, in the sense that each time someone requests a video through Netflix, whether it's on a mobile phone, on a computer, on a set-top box, etc., the logic to route those incoming requests, all the business logic related to that, routing, etc., is done thanks to Groovy script with the Netflix Zool. So the 60 million or so customers of Netflix are actually implicitly Groovy users somehow. Groovy 2.0, very, very important release with the introduction of the invoke dynamics support and the static type checking and static compilation, making Groovy pretty much as fast as Java or even slightly faster in some cases. So big, big release. Some project coined that were the small syntactical changes to Java 7. That were integrated into Groovy 2 as well, most of them. And we made Groovy more modular so that you don't have to use the big monolithic Groovy jar, Groovy old jar, but now you can just pick up the dependency you're interested in. 2013, Edward Snowden. So, Pivotal was a spin off of VMware. With the Cloud Foundry stuff, the Spring Source stuff, and some other stuff from EMC. So we were part of Pivotal at that point. Some more stuff. Top left, there's Lazy Bones, Grain, and for static site generation, etc. Some cool stuff there as well. Groovy 2.1, some further, let's say, improvements, not necessarily big new features, but continuous improvement in the type checking support, the invoke dynamics support, etc. Groovy 2.2, we were trying to get ready for Java 8 so that you could use closures wherever you would be able to use Java lambda expressions. So we worked on that even before Java 8 was released. 2014. Java 8 at least is there. Elasticsearch bundles Groovy for by default for all the custom logic and so on. The other logo is GBench, a small utility for doing benchmarks. Groovy 2.3, yeah, we added traits, so it's a nice addition. There's a new markup template engine, which is as at the same time dynamic and statically compiled. Plus some new ST transformations, etc. And when I say improve JDK 8 support, that's the ability to run Groovy on JDK 8. Although Groovy doesn't yet support the particular syntax enhancements of Java 8, it will really come only once we have a new grammar. With added Java 8 features, but it's not there yet. But, you know, with all the features provided by Groovy, you don't really need, we already have closures, and you can use closures where you can use lambda, etc. So there's not such a big incentive to add that super rapidly, or the things like the stream API in Java 8, it's no problem. You can already use it with the latest version of Groovy. There's no problem with that. 2015, that's the year where people decide to fire us, the Green and Grails teams. And by the way, that's also when Codehouse was closing. So it's been a big year for Groovy and the team, the full-time team behind the projects, and for Grails as well. So we wondered whether it would have any impact, and Ken already showed the numbers, basically. From 1.7 million downloads in 2012 up to 12.7 million downloads in a year in 2015. So that's really a nice growth. And if you look at the current figures for the first 4 months of this year, 3.4 million from Main Central. You can add the numbers from Bintray, that's 3 million from Bintray, and that's a total of 6.4 million downloads just for 4 months. So if you multiply that by 3, we can expect, by the end of the year, perhaps Groovy will have been downloaded 20 million times, which is a really big number for an open source Java project. Really, really big number. And we'll see if Kotlin and Grail in decisions have an impact on that or not. That's going to be interesting to see. Groovy 2.4. So Groovy 2.4 is a bit of an old story, but I'll go quickly through what we added then. So Groovy 2.4 came up with some Android support, so you can use Groovy to create Android applications. And there's a nice project called Swiss Knife, which adds some nice syntax sugar libraries and helper methods for developing Groovy applications, Android applications in Groovy. As we were working on the Android support, it was also a good opportunity to improve in terms of performance and size of bytecode, etc., the runtime of Groovy. So we trimmed down the bytecode a little bit. There were some places where we managed to reduce the memory consumption as well. And when you create Android applications, you often hit the limit of 64k methods. You cannot have more than 64k methods in an Android application, which is a limitation. Well, there are workarounds around that, but so we try to reduce things as much as possible so that Groovy wouldn't add too many methods to that count. Little refinement to the trace feature. There's a special annotation, so it's not an AST transformation, so it's more a marker annotation. So let's say you've got a component with a do something method, and when you use static type checking or static type compilation, here you notice that I've got a do something method, and the thing it's saying there is that this trait can only be applied to components or subclasses of components. So if you made a typo there, it would tell you something like, did you mean to invoke do something instead of something else? I don't know what the typo could have been. So it's an additional compile time safety aspect, so that you can specialize somehow traits to be applied only to certain classes. And this is where you would use it. So you extend the component and implement the traits. Some new improvements in the GDK, some new methods, current time in seconds, some new things with indices for lists, some more support. So historically, all the GDK methods were, especially those working with collections, were always returning new collections, etc. And we more and more move towards using iterators or iterables instead, so that you can really stream pretty much like the stream API instead of creating intermediary collections in your in the various steps, final, collect, etc. So it's a little bit of an optimization, if you will, but it behaves the same way, but at least consumes less memory. Some new AST transformation related changes. What else? Yeah, package scope for constructors. Some new parameters to some existing transformations like toString, etc. Groovish. Who's using the Groovy shell? Usually not many people. Usually tend to use Groovy console. Groovy console. Yeah, more Groovy console users usually. But it's been improved quite nicely. Some new commands, some profile scripts, startup scripts, which can be handy if you want to prepare a Groovy console with a certain state or things pre-configured, etc. And here come the Indians with the move to the Apache Software Foundation. So with Codehouse closing and Pivotal firing us, basically, we decided that it was time to do something for the project and show that the project was not at the mercy of a particular company. So we wanted to send this message to the community that the project is here to stay. And usually when a project is at the Apache Foundation, you can expect it to last a little bit longer, although there are also Apache projects in their attic. So we wanted to say we're independent of any company. and that the community matters above all. So that's what we value for our community. So we became an Apache project. We entered the incubation, and last November, the Apache board voted to agree to Groovy becoming a top-level project. So now you can call us Apache Groovy instead of just Groovy. And we released 246 under the Apache banner in last February. And I don't know if we'll have the time, but we would love to make a new release, perhaps during GreatConf. So I'm not sure we'll be able to make it. But that would be nice to have a 247, because there were some nice improvements, plus a first beta for Groovy 2.5. Because some of the new things I'll be mentioning later on, some are only for 2.5 and not for the 2.4x branch. Can also mention that since the beginning of the year, we've been part of the Tiobi Index. It's more of a pissing contest somehow, because Tiobi is essentially the number of search results in Google and things like that. So take it with a pinch of salt, because it doesn't mean much, but at least the bad buzz with Pivotal and the positive buzz with moving to the Apache Foundation clearly improved our results in search engines, basically. But the download numbers also show that there's increased usage, but still that's interesting to see that we're entering some such language comparison index. Also, we created an Apache Groovy Twitter account, which has got more than 1,500 followers. So if you want to follow the latest news about Groovy and interesting tweets, don't hesitate to follow us on Twitter, at Apache Groovy on Twitter. So now let's focus on these little improvements to 2.4. So that's changes since 2.4.4, 2.4.5, 2.4.6, plus some stuff that will be only in 2.5. Okay, so this is the big list, but I'll go through them. Add canonical. So two transforms like add immutable and add canonical are actually somehow bundling other transforms like add toString, add equals and hashcode, add tuple constructor, add immutable for immutable classes, but canonical is like immutable but without the immutable part. So that's the combination of those transforms, but without the immutability. So it's for mutable data. So canonical became a meta-annotation. So meta-annotation is a way to, in Groovy, to define an annotation that actually bundles or is replaced at compile time. One annotation is replaced at compile time by a set of annotations or AST transformations. And before, immutable and canonical were not meta-annotations. They were reusing parts of these other transforms. But this time, canonical and immutable, and this immutable was already a meta-annotation, I think, but canonical, that's new in 2.4 something. I don't remember in which version we added that. So it's more detailed, because for you, it doesn't matter much. But for us, it was important to avoid all the code duplication and so on. And there are some additional benefits, like how you can decide how to tweak at canonical with the other transforms, etc. But that doesn't matter much. Some little details. And speaking of the annotation collector, which is used for meta annotations, there's some more fine-tuning ways to customize how meta-annotations are working, especially in the case where the annotations that you combine overlap in terms of in terms of the parameters of those annotations. So you have more control of that. There's a map constructor now. So historically, you could already call something like this, new author, first, last, etc. But now there's a dedicated transform for that. With what's interesting is that there are two parameters to that annotation and transform, pre and post conditions, so that you can do something before and after the execution of the constructor. So, for example, you can decide that you want to put the first name in uppercase. You want to do some checks on the values which are passed in the map constructor. So it's a way as well to potentially do some checks that wouldn't have been possible or that you would have had to implement at the constructor level. So it's a nice addition. And this one is pretty new. We also added the pre and post conditions to tuple constructor. So here in this example, the first example, automatically I'm lowercasing the first field there, the first property. And I also have another example there that if you try to, so here I'm checking that the first name was passed. If I didn't pass anything, there's going to be an assertion failure at construction time, which means that when you try to instantiate the person here, it's not going to work because you didn't pass the first name. So it's also a way to ensure that objects, instances of a class annotated with tuple constructor, are correctly constructed. Another one for the transforms which are dealing with properties like autoclone, which includes and excludes annotation parameter. That's a string there, the parameter that you pass. But what's happening there is that if I made a typo in the field name, the property name, I'm going to get a compilation error. So it's not going to be an error at runtime, but it's really going to be an error at compilation time when the AST transformation is applied. Tuple constructor, if you use tuple constructor, perhaps you're not aware of that, but tuple constructor, so which adds this kind of constructor there, first, last, age, in the same order as it's been defined in the order of the properties inside the class. But there are actually other constructors which are provided removing the last argument each time. So you've got the one with the three parameters, two parameters, one, and zero as well. And there's a new parameter to this annotation. When you enable that one, there will be only one tuple constructor, which is the one taking the three of the properties of that class. Immutable support. So there was a limitation with the at immutable transform. You had to, so I'm going to show the whole example. You couldn't have an immutable class like athlete there that would extend a class that wasn't immutable, or you couldn't even extend at all. I don't remember. It's one or the other, or both. And now I can extend person, although this one, the class person, wasn't immutable. And then I can customize the at immutable with those parameters. So although at immutable is a meta annotation, you can then customize the annotations which are bundled with that meta annotation. So here, so what I did, so you have the tuple constructor, you have the usual named parameter constructor, etc. A little enhancement to the Groovy shell. Before, I actually didn't know it wasn't working, but you couldn't use grab inside Groovy shell. Now there's a dedicated command, colon grab, to say, okay, I want to grab a particular dependency in my Groovy shell script. Delegate could only be applied to properties or fields. Add delegate now can be used on getters as well. So in this example,
I'm actually delegating, so two uppercase becomes available because there's an add delegate on this string property. So here, if I do that, p dot to uppercase, it's going through the delegation and through the it's going to call the get name instead of the default getter that would have been name in the normal case. There are some new shortcuts for JaxB. So I'm not sure is there anyone using JaxB here. Probably not many. Yeah, one. Not many. So there are a couple new shortcuts. So it's not that much of a big shortcut, but before, so I don't remember JaxB all that much, but you had to do JaxB context dot something dot Marshall, or I don't remember. Oh yeah, a new marshaller or new unmarshaller or new converter or something. There were some intermediary methods in those two calls there. So it's a little shortcut to make working with JaxB slightly more concise. And what else? Some MISC stuff. Some new methods on maps to retain only certain keys or values or remove certain keys or values. So inside the closure here, it can take either the map entry or key and value. So you can just pass E arrow or K comma V arrow. So like you used to do with map related methods. When we work with the different collections and maps, sometimes in the GDK we used to create a new array list or a hash map. But as much as possible, we are always trying to create the same kind of collection, the same kind of map. So if a final on a linked list, we're going to return a linked list instead of an array list. That's the kind of stuff we do. So that you still get the same particularities of the collection you put in entry. And a new relative path method and file. Right, so that's about it, about the small additions to the various 2.4x versions as well as the upcoming 2.5 version. So I should have given you the breakdown, so which one is in which version, but you'll have to find out. next time perhaps if I do that slide deck again, I should specify in which version that was added, but I didn't really keep track. I only tried on the snapshot version of 2.5, so I didn't double check with which version of Groovy that those little changes were added. So Groovy, it's been a long road, since 2003. Groovy is really a very mature language nowadays, used quite widely. So even if it's small usage, small community compared to the overall Java community, it's really a significant community and significant effort. And an ecosystem, with projects like Gradle, like Grails, etc. It's really very active, a very positive community and ecosystem. So it's a long road, but we are far from the end. And even if you get some warnings, Grail's gonna use Kotlin, etc. I mean, there's still a big and bright future to Groovy. Don't worry about that. And last but not least, there's no full-time committer anymore on Groovy, so that's why we develop the project a little bit more slowly. But there are actually new committers who are contributing various improvements to the project, and lots of the improvements I've mentioned were also contributed by those new committers. But ultimately, Groovy is what you make of the project, and those new committers who came to the project brought their own, ideas and improvements, etc. And it's always been like that. I mean, throughout the life of the project, we got new, fresh blood adding new ideas and helping moving Groovy forward. But it's very important that each of you help in a way or another. That might be just, reporting a bug report or
sometimes it could be a typo in the documentation, but any contribution is a great contribution. So don't hesitate, don't be shy. Come to us, discuss ideas, etc. Or like we mentioned in the talk with Ken, we mentioned the Eclipse support. If you've got Eclipse knowledge, perhaps it's not much to make the Eclipse plugin back in shape with the latest, to work with the latest version of Groovy, etc. There are ways you can help. And for example, some of the persons who were there last year, I'm not sure if he's there. One of the guys who's working on the new Hunter grammar, we actually talked about the grammar last year at GreatConf, so don't hesitate to join and help with those things. All right, so thanks a lot for your attention, and we've got 5-6 minutes for some quick questions and answers. So any question? I mean, since we're in the dark, I'm not really seeing any hands raising.
No questions.
Oh, yeah, thanks. Now I see you. No, so you're not sleeping. That's great. So any question? Yeah, yep. Mac.
So what's the plan for GroovyShoot.io?
Yeah, it's what you're going to make with it, you know? You're going to contribute. So Groovy 3, we want to have this new grammar, potentially a new joint compiler, perhaps some revised MOP, the one that we've been promising since 2007, I think. So that's the kind of changes we could get in Groovy 3, but currently there's no concrete plan or date or anything like that for Groovy 3. So it's not that we're not promising that there will be a Groovy 3 or not or anything like that, but it's like, you know, the far future where we want to head to. But otherwise, time will tell. There's no big plan there. Any other question? No. Well, thanks a lot.